All right, good afternoon. If I could ask everyone to please take a seat, we'll do our final panel presentation here at today's conference. My name is Tom Heywood. It's my great privilege and pleasure to have a chance to moderate this panel, which is economic development in Southern West Virginia as part of our Revitalizing Southern West Virginia workshop here this afternoon. I hope that each of you is as excited as I am about what I've heard today, the information I've learned and gained, and the sense of opportunity that we truly have here in Southern West Virginia. It's just a delight. I'm excited all over again about what our future is and can be. And some of the themes I think we've heard already in today's remarks, incubating entrepreneurship, creating jobs. I think for so long we haven't thought about getting up in the morning and creating a job. And we've heard very clearly that we are now at that juncture where we are going to get up tomorrow morning, each and every one of us, and create jobs, and create pipelines, and create new lives and opportunities. And we see some real living examples. It's very exciting. And so we are at the threshold of all that activity, so aren't we blessed? The panelists here today, we have one substitution. I'll get to that. I'm going to do the introductions a little bit differently. I'm going to just take them one by one and introduce them and then ask them to give their opening remarks. We're shrinking this panel discussion. We were set for an hour and a half to kind of keep us on schedule. We're going to go to an hour and 15 total. And so what we'll do, we'll go down and have remarks from our panelists. They can share their stories. They can talk about the opportunity as they see it. And then we'll go directly to your questions. I've got a great list of questions I'm just burning to ask, but we want this to be a forum. We want this to be your meeting, and we want your ideas, and that's what you've heard. So with that, let me introduce first here to my immediate left, Rusty Justice. Rusty is with BitSource, and you say, and Rusty's from Kentucky. So that's okay. His wife is from Holden, I understand, so it's all good. But as we go big and as we think regional, this is really part of us, right? This is clearly us. Rusty's been involved in business in Pike County since 1985. He's currently the managing member of BitSource LLC. It's a web development company specializing in content management and open source frameworks. He's also a managing member of Jigsaw Enterprises, an engineering and land forming company, a stockholder in Eastern Telephone and Technologies, Inc., which is a communications and IT firm. These are all located in Pikeville. He has a Bachelor of Sciences from the University of Kentucky in both mining and civil engineering. He serves on several boards of directors. He has an appreciation of Eastern Kentucky's and also Southern West Virginia's rich heritage, and he works to leverage all of his capabilities to grow the local economy. So we heard earlier from people who are doing that, Jenny and Brandon and Stanley. We talk about people who are making the future, and Rusty is one of those people who's making the future, but still building on our resources, redeploying our resources, preserving those assets, and making that future very bright. So Rusty, without further ado, let me ask you to talk about what you're doing and give us some excitement.
Okay. Well, thank you, and I'm happy to be here and really feel at home here in Southern West Virginia. I always say that Eastern Kentucky and Southern West Virginia are really almost the same place. I'm over here a lot, very familiar with all these little towns around here, and my wife still has family here, so here a lot. I'm thankful that Southern West Virginia raised up the girl of my dreams, and so I'm totally indebted to you guys for that. And I'm a lifelong resident of the Big Sandy Valley. My daughter's the fifth generation to be born there, so like a lot of you folks in this room, have really deep roots here in the mountains. And spent my life and career in and around coal mining, love coal mining. I'm a mining engineer, and thought that would always be my career. And a few years ago, my partner and I decided that we could see a downturn coming in the coal economy, and we were looking for ways to diversify and find jobs, because we have a great respect for those men and women that that work in and around the coal industry, and I'm sure everyone here knows what I'm talking about. And so we started about 4 years ago on a kind of a voyage of adventure and looking outside what we were normally comfortable with. And we investigated solar farms and wind farms and farms. And we looked for any kind of business, and we traveled. And we asked a lot of questions. We read a lot of books. And heard a young lady on the panel here this morning mention SOAR. And SOAR is a thing that was started by a Democratic governor and a Republican congressman, a bipartisan effort in a response to the downturn of the coal economy for our grassroots solutions, nonpartisan solutions-based organization, and consisting of the people in the communities. And it goes past any political boundary. We have the same struggles you have here, I'm sure. County governments, little city governments, everyone focused, rightfully so, on what it is their task to be responsible for, but not seeing past that. And the problems we all face are truly cross these boundaries, and they cross the Tug River. And so that's why I agreed to come here today. I'm a big believer in regional cooperation, collaboration, and the things that we can get from the synergies that we could create. So anyway, we go on a fact-finding tour, and a guy tells us about coding. Now, I had computer science back in the early days of computers, and I was familiar with computer science, but I'm not an expert in that field. But he said something that I could understand and my partner could understand, was that coding was a trade, much like welding. Now, welding was something, being from the mining industry, I truly understood. I'd worked welders lots of times. And it was a skill, something you could attain. It was not a four-year baccalaureate degree, which is how I envisioned it. And it was something people could level up on. But what really got our attention was he said this, fully developed, full-stack developers can earn wages equivalent to those of the mining industry. Now, so much of what we hear and so many of the things we investigate are all worthwhile, but they are lower-paying jobs than our men and women are accustomed to. And so we came back. It's about an hour's drive from my house here. It was about a two-hour drive to central Kentucky where we went and heard this guy talk to us that day. As we drove home that day, we just kept mulling that over. Here's something that you know, could our folks do that? Could a coal miner learn to code? That was really became the question. And when we came home a little while after that, Michael Bloomberg donated $50 million to the Sierra Club and toward the Beyond Coal campaign. And in it, someone asked him, said, what are these coal miners going to do? And he said, I don't know, but they sure aren't going to learn to code. And that lit our fuse. And so my partner Lynn and I committed right then to try this. And so we started seeking out people from our region. That's the other thing that I believe is really important. What we've done is it's a grassroots effort by people from Eastern Kentucky that are not coming in here to save us, but we're working to save ourselves. And so we started asking who in the community knows about computer coding. We found those folks, we identified them, we hired three, and we found what a profile of the thinking and behavior styles of a person that's successful in coding was. We tested against those and we advertised, and we were hoping we would get 50 applicants, and we got 950 applicants, and blew us away. I mean, it really shut us down. We weren't set up to process that much documentation. So we wrote a database, thought, well, we're a tech company, let's write a database. So we did, we wrote certain queries, we got it down to that. We tested again, and against that, we took the scores. Not surprisingly to us, lots of people scored with these aptitudes. And a few years earlier, I'd had the opportunity to take an astronaut in a coal mine. He'd been in space three times. And when he came out, he said this, and it always stuck with me. You know, you guys use technology that's equivalent to what we use in the space program. And I thought, gosh, you know, this all just, you know, comes together. Really, we have high-tech workers here. We just get dirty and we kind of talk funny. But we have a great work ethic. I don't have to tell you about the work ethic of the people in the coal field. And so I always say we're a tech company without a ping pong table. We don't need to incite our people to work. They show up and they work. So we developed a curriculum. We got a grant from the Department of Labor, Workforce Development Grant. The governor, I heard the governor reference those training funds. We got some of those. We paid the trainers. And why we work, have been successful, is we have skin in the game. We've got $3 for every dollar the government's got in this adventure. And so we hired these folks, gave them a paying job on day one, took them all off of unemployment, put them to work, and said work or go home. Didn't have to really say that. That wasn't necessary. We've trained these folks. They've all passed. And we have a representative cross sample of our region. We have people from every county in the Big Sandy River. And we have people, three surface miners, three underground miners, and three people that worked in industry support. And then one person that was non-coal, because not everyone is a coal miner or works in the coal industry in here. We wanted that representative cross sample, that proof of concept that this could work. And it did, and it has. And 2 weeks ago, a guy that was running a shuttle car just a couple years before gave a talk in Manhattan, a tech talk at a major publicly traded tech firm, and demonstrated to them what he had learned. And he was right at home there. So it can be done. You can do it. And I thank you for having me here. Thank you.
What an exciting story. Tech company without a ping pong table. Homegrown, grassroots, right here. Just gets me excited. Congratulations. Thanks for your entrepreneurship, your setting forward on your adventure, learning, reading books, and then making it happen. And we wish you continued success. I suspect you'll have some questions coming up. Our next presenter here this afternoon on this panel is Jamie Cope, seated to the left of Rusty. Jamie is the Interim Director of Innovation and Entrepreneurship at RCBI, Robert C. Byrd Institute. He's from Scott Depot. He heads up the Innovation and Entrepreneurship Program there at RCBI. He focuses on startups. His day-to-day activities include startups with existing manufacturers, early-stage funding initiatives. Again, we're talking about turning ideas into reality. That's what we are about here collectively and individually. He leads RCBI's development of a makerspace at the Huntington Advanced Manufacturing Technology Center. Prior to his current job, Jamie has done other things in this very sphere. He's worked for Southern West Virginia Community and Technical College, based right here. He's also worked for the West Virginia Department of Commerce, and he's an entrepreneur himself. I dare say everyone on this panel is an entrepreneur with a great entrepreneurial story. He is the founder and president of Destiny Images, a computer animation and media production company that he's received numerous awards for both quality and creativity. And he earned his mechanical engineering degree from Washington University in St. Louis, Missouri. Jamie, tell us what you're up to. Tell us your story.
Yeah, well, first I want to say it's a humbling honor to be up here on the panel and just a part of this great day. So thanks so much for that opportunity. With RCBI, I get asked a lot, what is RCBI and what is it that they do at the Robert C. Byrd Institute? So I've been working on my elevator pitch, and hopefully our elevator doesn't go all the way from the Empire State Building and back. But basically, if I was going to put it in a sentence, RCBI supports manufacturing in just about every way. We've got one of the things that we're most known for is our shared manufacturing. We have facilities in Huntington and South Charleston and Bridgeport where we have really great things I like to call them toys, but maybe that's not the best way to describe them. But we've got laser cutters, CNC machines, water jets, And those pieces of equipment are available for people from the industry or just people off the street to come in and learn how to use and use them for their projects, whether it's, again, for industry or just for a home project. We also have a quality division there at RCBI. We deal with ISO training, lean training, things like that. With more established businesses, we can help you get those kinds of certifications. One of the big focuses with us right now, that's probably a lot of interest to the people in this room, is apprenticeships. We got a $4.9 million grant from the EDA to help set up apprenticeship programs. One of the more successful ones that we've had here recently is with Mohawk. We've partnered with Southern and some of our other friends there to help set up a training program that was personalized to what they needed. And it's been so successful there that they're gonna take it and spread it to their other locations all over the country. We've got another division of RCBI that deals with agricultural innovations. In fact, in a couple of weeks, we've got a training session going on in Bridgeport on how to use unmanned aircraft to inspect fence lines or crops, keep up with your goat herd or whatever you're working with. So any kind of innovation in agriculture, we help support that as well. We deal with education. We've got sections that work with welding, machinists, and we're one of the few places that gives a NIM certification, so that we are turning out some very quality people in those areas that are ready to go right into the workforce. And the next part is one of the things that I'm working with most closely, and I liked what Secretary Burdett said earlier today about how do you eat an elephant, and it's one bite at a time, but you don't have to eat the elephant all by yourself either. There can be lots of people eating that elephant with you. So one of the things that we do, we have this early stage funding opportunities. And it's basically open, it targets a lot of the southern West Virginia, but there's other parts of the state as well. And people can come in with ideas for improvements on existing machines, new machines, and basically pitch those. It's very much like Shark Tank, if you've ever seen that show. I mean, people come in and they have an idea for a machine or something like that. It's also kind of like American Idol, because the ones that are really bad are the most fun sometimes. But so they come in, they pitch their ideas, and we have some assistance that we can give them with our expertise in engineering and the machining, and if it's additive manufacturing, our 3D printers, so we can help them get a prototype or get their design in place and help them find a way to get that manufactured. And I think that those little bites are probably where a lot of the solution is gonna come from. It's not gonna be one big, this is it. It's gonna be lots of little things that take off. And I just jotted down a few off the top of my head that to give you some of the idea of the diversity of what we're dealing with. We had a company called MROC that's down in Peterstown, West Virginia. They make decorative rocks that you can hang on the wall. It's kind of like bricks, right, with no mortar. But they were coming up with a system to do that. They're very successful, but they needed to try something a little bit different. They needed to get stage two of their program together or their product. And we were able to help them by using 3D printing develop some prototypes a whole lot faster, a whole lot cheaper, so that stage two is getting ready to hit the market here in just a few months. So it's really exciting to see that one turn around really quickly. There's a company called Martech. There's 7 full-time employees there now, we're told. There was a big breaker switch that this gentleman was required to flip, and if he flipped it and it malfunctioned, he could be in a lot of trouble. So he didn't like to stand in front of that. So he has developed, or this company has developed, a switch that will attach to the device that will attach to the switch, and then they can remotely flip the switch. Which is safer for everybody. And we had a lot of help with our folks from Tech Connect and other folks with a lot of these. I'm glossing over a lot of it. We even had something as simple as, and this one is still in development, a gentleman who raises horses had a problem with his horse feed bucket wasn't staying on the fence. And he got so frustrated that he couldn't find anything in the market that would fit that niche, so he just decided he would design his own. And he has sat down with our engineers, and they've worked on the best way to get this horse feed system to work on or livestock feed system to stay on a fence. And it's going to it looks to be very successful. We'll just say it that way. There's nothing in the market like that. He's working on it to get that together. Also had a great trip recently, and this wasn't with the early stage funding, but it is an RCBI success story. There was a company that I visited earlier in the week that does, they make the molds for extrusion molds, a lot of plastic parts for Anderson windows and places like that. And they were telling this very romantic story. It's romantic now because they're successful, about how they had a lawn chair that they would set up in the locker room at RCBI so that they could field their calls while they were using our machines. Because they came in, they didn't have the equipment, they didn't have the facility, but they knew what they wanted to do and they knew there was a market for it. So they started working really hard and again, ran their office with a cell phone and a lawn chair in our locker room for a little while. Now they have a facility that hires 13 people, that has 13 people full-time, full benefits, just a great success story, and they have as much work as they can keep up with. So again, I think those kinds of smaller success stories coming out of these early stage funding opportunities is the kind of stuff that we would like to see more of. We'd like to see more of it happen around here.
Jamie, thank you very much. So I'm intrigued by the idea of a West Virginia or Southern West Virginia Shark Tank or American Idol, and we've already heard some great ideas coming out here, and the thought, again, collaboration, one person doesn't have to eat the entire elephant. I like those concepts. I'll tell you, Bob Brown referenced the Reconnecting McDowell meeting that was held earlier this week, and there was a representative of RCBI at that meeting, and they were talking about working in the McDowell County Schools, creating a robotics team in McDowell County and bringing robotics to McDowell County, and that's getting underway very quickly. So we've got rocket boys. Pretty soon we're going to have robot boys and girls. It's going to be great stuff, right? So it's terrific. Now you get for your money, it's a twofer. So with this next story is really two stories. So you see she doesn't have a name tent in front of her. This is Kristina Oliver from the West Virginia Small Business Development Center. So these are two great stories. So the first great story is Matt Dolan, who Christina's going to talk about, who's listed in your program and was here all day until about 12 minutes ago. And he had to run out. So he's a laid-off coal miner who's created a great business. She's going to tell you all about it. He had to run out because their business was swamped. Seven customers in the store there, and the only person manning it was his mother. So he had to run back and help his mom out and get those customers taken care of on a Friday afternoon. And so as we think about the difference between coal mining and being laid off after every nine months and getting called back and going to the family thing that Brandon talked about, we've got that great success story with someone having to run out right now to tend to his new business. So Kristina works with Matt. She's an entrepreneur herself. She created her first business at age 23. She's been at this business for a long time. She's been 6 years in her current position, and she works closely with Matt and his company, among others. So why don't you tell us those stories, Kristina?
Thank you very much. And I'm pleased to be able to sit in for Matt. And I'll have to have one little correction. Okay. I don't personally work with Matt. Our business coaches have worked with Matt. So just want to let you know that. And I'll tell you a little bit about that. You kind of stole my thunder, because I was so thrilled to be able to say that his business is doing so well that he had to go. And as a small business owner, it's very difficult to take a huge chunk of time out during your day, you know, to focus on this. So, and in your program, the last statement says, Matt and his team are already seeing tremendous growth. And that is the huge underline to this story. Matt worked in the coal industry for, I think, about 12 or 13 years. And then, of course, he received his layoff notice. And he was trying to determine what his next move would be. Our coal miners, everybody that works in the coal industry, they have skills. They have marketable skills. But sometimes they don't think about those skills as being able to use those skills in different capacities. Sometimes, if you just pivot to a market opportunity, you can use the skills that you've been using for years and years, and you can create a new business. And that's what Matt did. But before Matt took that plunge and put everything at risk, he sought out the Small Business Development Center Business Fundamentals session down in Putnam County. He attended one down there. And it was a 3-hour session where it's just like it says, he learned the fundamentals of going into business. And at the end of that session, he determined that he wanted to go see a business coach. So he went to see our very own Brian Shaw, who is a business coach through Advantage Valley. We have a partnership with Advantage Valley. Brian also has an office right at RCBI. Are you getting the connecting the dots here? Anyway, he worked effectively with that business coach, and he was able to seek seed funding through a bank. Didn't happen the first time around. He was positioned well. He was kind of a different type of story. He'd been saving his money, so he was positioned well to be able to approach a bank. Unfortunately, the first bank that he went to, and I hope he doesn't mind, I guess since he's not here, I can say all this stuff. The first bank turned him down, told him, you've been working in coal mine at this level of pay. Now you want to start a business? You see the dilemma? So instead of taking that and saying, oh, I give up, he and Brian got to work and they went to a community bank that said, absolutely. And so he started his company. They found land for a place for him to lease. He started, and then he hired two people. He hired two guys that had worked beside him in the coal industry. And then within like 2 or 3 months, he was positioned to have an expansion. And so he has taken everything that he learned working in the mines, and he has pivoted that to respond to a market opportunity. But he didn't do it alone. He didn't jump without a parachute, as they say. He sought out resources to help him understand and learn, because entrepreneurs and small businesses sometimes don't know what they don't know. So seeking out others to help you grow and to increase that skill level will help you to be ultimately successful. Now I look around this room, and of course I have no prepared notes because they grabbed me like 5 minutes ago. But today has just been awesome, because anybody that knows me knows that, number one, I'm an entrepreneur, I've been a small business owner, and I truly believe from the soles of my feet to the depths of my heart that West Virginians are entrepreneurial. That's originally how we began, and I really believe that that is a turning point for us in a new economy. Now look around the room. SBDC, Small Business Development Center, in case you don't know, we provide technical assistance to help small businesses and individuals to start companies, to start, grow, and succeed. I had the honor of working with Secretary Byrd in the West Virginia Development Office. I look around this room, SBDC has worked for the last 6 years to partner effectively, because none of us can do this alone. I learned that as a very young entrepreneur. you can't learn anything in a silo. You have to reach out. You have to leverage the resources that are available to you. That's what Matt did. He sought out business fundamentals. He sought out a business coach. He even sought out Governor's Guaranteed Workforce training for his folks. And then here's the other thing to it. He brought in another business coach, who's here today, Doug Spaulding. Doug came in and worked with Matt's mother on QuickBooks, because she's doing the booking, keeping end of the business. But as we all sit here today and we look around and we connect these dots, connect, and we know that it's going to take bold moves, to use some of Keith's terminology, bold moves, entrepreneurial moves, to reinvent ourselves. We can do it. We've done it before. We did it in the beginning. I don't see why we can't take a challenge and turn it into opportunity. And I was at Kevin's event last night, and I was telling somebody, you know, when you have ultimate challenges, sometimes that's when the most creative innovations come to light. So I know we can do it. I think entrepreneurship and small business is, I don't like the term small business, because it makes it, small business is big business. 97% of our businesses, our companies in West Virginia, are small. It's time that we put them on the platform that they need to be up here. When you talk about a magnificent opportunity like the Hobet, like the P&Gs, like the Macy's, you also have to consider the secondary and tertiary businesses, small businesses, that encompass and circle those major investments. And you know, when you create 20 small businesses, they root deep into our communities, they're committed, and they don't all get up at once and leave. They become the fabric of who we are in West Virginia. And everybody that knows me here knows that I'm pretty passionate about this. And when I'm honored, I am honored to speak for someone like Matt Dolan, you know, who ran out to take care of business as he should. I would have done the same thing. With all due respect to all the honorary people here, business comes first. And as we move forward together, and it's got to be done together, let's keep that in mind too. So, you know, we've talked about education, and we've talked about training, we talked about all this. And when we ask things of our small businesses, let's remember, and entrepreneurs, remember, they got to take care of business, right? So we want them to come, we want them to give their testimonials, but you know what? They got to take care of business. And I would have done the same thing. So I'm honored to speak for Matt. I'm honored to be here today and to see so many friends and partners, and to know that the SBDC has become sticky. We're sticky because we've been talking to all of you, and we hope to expand that. And so with that, that's my spiel.
Thank you, Kristina. That was a great command performance. Boy, that was literally on the run, on the fly. Did you catch him in the parking lot? I know you were running out.
We were trying to find him.
She was running out to try to see if there was anything in particular he wanted to say, but I think he had already gone to take care of business. So as I listen, Kristina, thank you very much. As I listen to Matt's story, and thinking about him taking the plunge, going to Putnam County, and then following up with the coaches, I think about Stanley's story and taking the plunge. I think Brandon talked about Andy's story and taking the plunge and so forth. There were questions earlier about how do we support that, whether in students or in budding entrepreneurs. And I think that's something maybe we can have conversation about later. How do we make sure that that ecosystem, that infrastructure is there that begins to support that activity? Another thought that occurred to me as you were speaking, Kristina, you really framed this as perhaps what's going on here is that we are rediscovering our entrepreneurial roots. I don't know how many of you have had the opportunity to visit the Heritage Farm and Village. I'll always call it Mike Perry's. I guess it's now Audie Perry's. But, you know, telling the story of Appalachia is really one of great entrepreneurialism, and perhaps we are, what we're doing right now is returning to our roots. And it's an interesting way, I think, to think about this juncture in our history. Our next panelist, seated to the left, my left, your right, I guess, of Kristina, is Justin Seibert. Justin is a president of Direct Online Marketing. He's been involved in search engine marketing since 2001. That's 15 years ago now, time flies, when he worked for a Los Angeles-based financial firm. He built their internet marketing program from scratch into a multi-million dollar per year revenue generator, and then he brought his talent back to West Virginia. He came to West Virginia in 2006, returned to West Virginia. I've done some work with Justin. He returned to from California in 2006. He founded Direct Online Marketing. It is headquartered in Wheeling, and he does business and has a team that uses skills to build programs for companies across the globe. It's a digital marketing firm. They provide SEO, search engine optimization services, internet advertising strategies, social media management, and other services related to online presence and reputation. He has exported his services. He has taken his business to every continent on the planet. He's been awarded the Governor's Export Award. He's worked with exporters in West Virginia to help them succeed, right? We all win together. And he's a member of the West Virginia District Export Council. Justin, tell us about how you did it and where you see some opportunity.
Cool. Thank you, Tom. Good afternoon, everybody.
Afternoon.
Come on. Good afternoon, everybody. I know we're coming after lunch. I get it. All right. Now, you probably heard Tom say something that didn't sound quite right. He said he came back to West Virginia and came to Wheeling. I double-checked Wheeling is a part of West Virginia. I just want to get that out on the table right now. All right, so my business, Tom brought it up, but we help our businesses grow, our clients grow their businesses through digital marketing. And we're a top 200 Google partner. And we're doing all of that from West Virginia, which excites me to no end. And what I just realized today while I was sitting up here, about 8 years ago, I was sitting at a Generation West Virginia, I think in Morgantown, where I think I saw Tom there as well. And then Governor Manchin was at the table, and he was talking about small businesses. And he said once they reached the 10-year level, that was quite an accomplishment. And so this is the only humble brag I'll do up on stage today, but this is the month that I moved back from California, and my business is now 10 years old as of this month. Thank you. Now, I want to throw out a really big number, at least it's big to me, $5.7 billion. $5.7 billion. That's what exporting meant to West Virginia last year in direct exports. And West Virginia companies exported to over 140 countries around the globe. And it supported 20% of our jobs here. So those are huge numbers, and we don't talk about exporting a whole lot. So that's what I'm up here to talk to you about today. There's only three things I can talk to you about intelligently. One is digital marketing, and I didn't bring all my Google swag. The second is beer, and I didn't think that was appropriate. So the third is exporting. So when you look at those numbers, also consider U.S. exporters. Only 1% of companies in the United States export. 1% of companies. And of those, the majority never export to more than one country. So usually it's just to Canada, right? So if you're doing any exporting whatsoever, you're really ahead of the game, very far ahead of the national averages. I can tell you it'll be done. It sounds daunting, but just out of curiosity, are there any companies in the room that are exporting currently? Where are you exporting to currently? Excellent. And thank you very much for supporting and bringing those dollars into West Virginia that otherwise wouldn't be here. I talked about a few of our experiences. As Tom mentioned, we exported to every country, every continent around the world, except for Antarctica. We're still working on that one right now. But we've done a lot of different events. And the one thing I really want to stress to everybody is that there is all sorts of help out there available for you and for the businesses that you know. Obviously, Kristina talked about SBDC. Jamie talked about RCBI. I can personally vouch for how experienced and helpful these organizations are. There's the SBA, and then two that we haven't talked about that are here, and I think both represented today, are the West Virginia Development Office and the U.S. Commercial Service. And I'm telling you, all of those five organizations I just mentioned are the best value in business today. Many of the services they offer are free, And even some of the ones that they offer that there's a small charge to, it's an extremely great value and it's very minimal dollars and you're going to get a great return on investment. And these people's sole jobs are to help you and to help West Virginia grow their businesses, and they do a tremendous job. So Caitlin Ashley, if she's in the room. Caitlin, no, stand up, come on. You can do better than that. So Caitlin. Caitlin and Steve are with the West Virginia Development Office, and they have a table just outside that door. So when you go out, I'd encourage you to stop by and talk with Caitlin about what you can learn from them. They're every day pounding the pavement, working with companies, and making our state a better place. So any of these five organizations, please reach out to. I also serve on the West Virginia District Exporting Council Board, and that's a group appointed by the U.S. Secretary of Commerce of West Virginia exporters and those that help exporters to be able to spread the word, basically, to evangelize, to talk about how you can bring money into our country and into our state. There's tremendous opportunities there. You know, if you would have asked me 8 years ago, did I ever see myself in South America? The answer was no. And there I was in Argentina speaking to people, getting live translated at the time. So there are resources where you can grow your businesses these ways. One other service I want to quickly mention is the Goldman Sachs 10,000 Small Business Program. If none of you have ever heard of that, it's a free service put on by Goldman Sachs and Babson College. They're taking applications for this right now. Those applications are due, I believe, in 2 weeks. Every year in business, I look back at myself and say, I cannot believe how stupid I was last year. Without fail, every year it happens again. And one of the things that I think if you're an entrepreneur, and Kristina probably already had it all figured out when she was 23, but I didn't. And then you get embarrassed because you're like, I should know these things, but I don't know them. And you're scared. You don't know who to talk to, and you don't want to tell people about the things you don't know about. And you don't have that support system. I would just mention that whether it's the SBDC or whether it's the Goldman Sachs 10,000 Small Business Program, these resources are out there. Don't feel like you're on an island. There are lots of people out there that want to help you and want to give back to their community. And if I can answer any questions for anybody or point you in the right direction, please let me know. I'd love to do that. The last thing I'll mention, there are a couple great programs coming up. When you talk to Caitlin, you can ask her about some upcoming trade missions, both to Mexico that's coming up in June, and then also to Southeast Asia that's going to be happening in the fall. I'll also mention that there's a Trade Winds program that the U.S. Commercial Service is putting on to Chile and to South America. That's coming up in September 6th to 13th, and there's a webinar about that. So coming up next week on April 6th, it's a webinar that you can learn a little bit more about Argentina and about exporting and to see if this is right for you. Again, these things don't cost you any money or they're very inexpensive, and I'd encourage you to check it out. Even if you don't think it's something right for you, it might be in the future. So, thank you.
Justin, thank you very much. That's a very exciting success story. Congratulations on your 10-year anniversary. We can't imagine, you know, Antarctica is just, it's dead meat. It's dead meat. It's in your sights. It's going to happen. But what a wonderful story. You know, I think as we all think about exporting, as we all think about doing business internationally, I think it remains very daunting, right? It's still in our minds. It probably remains very daunting, just as this moment in time in Southern West Virginia remains very daunting. But there are people who have done it. It's huge untapped opportunity. If 99% of the companies haven't done it yet, let's begin to think that way and think about those markets. And thanks for sharing that success story and offering your support and guidance to those who might want to learn more. Our final panelist this afternoon is well known to you. He's really moderated the program for today, and he's a great leader for our state. And as you said earlier today, he's a great personal friend, I think not only to me, but I believe to every one of us in this room and tens of thousands more around the state of West Virginia. Keith Burdett is the Secretary of the West Virginia Department of Commerce. He's also the Executive Director of the West Virginia Development Office. Senator Burdett, President Burdett, he was elected to the House of Delegates at the age of 23. He's older than that now. He was elected to the Senate in 1989. He became the 42nd President of the West Virginia Senate at the age of 34. And to this day, he remains the youngest Senate President ever in the history of West Virginia. I recall those days. I had the opportunity to work in Governor Caperton's office when Keith was Senate President. And those were daunting times, folks. Those were daunting times. The budget that the state of, that the legislature and governor are grappling with right now, I think it's the most challenging budget since 1989, Mr. Secretary. And I can tell you, he took a lot of tough votes. He demonstrated remarkable leadership. He, President Tomlin, others are some of the key architects of the stability, the forward progress, and that we have achieved in the state of West Virginia over the past 25 years, and we can never thank him enough for all of that. He is an inspiring leader who leads an inspired team. I can tell you, if you walk around the development office or any of the agencies, there's a sense of excitement. He empowers folks. He's a remarkable leader. I've had the privilege of hearing Keith present all across the globe. Justin, to your comments, I heard him present at a trade show in Yokohama, Japan last May. I had the opportunity to be there. And let me tell you, folks, there is no one who can sell the state of West Virginia, other than the governor, better than Keith Burdett. And he is intensely loyal to our governor. He's intensely loyal to our state and each of us. He is a great leader. And I just can't wait to hear what you're going to say, Keith, to tell us about how we move forward at economic development. Keith Burdett.
Well, what I can start by saying is, Tom, in spite of that very gracious introduction, I'm not paying you for that. I have to tell you, I have sat here this afternoon, this morning, I have written, you can't see this, I've written so many notes across my notebook as this process has gone on. The one thing you and I have in absolute common is neither one of us have a clue what I'm about to say. There's just so many, to tell you the truth, there's so many inspiring stories. I'm listening to Justin, who talks about how dumb he was a year ago. I was considerably dumber 2 hours ago than I am right this minute. I listened to Stanley this morning. The passion that he has, he's reaching a difficult reach. We should never underestimate this. These are difficult reaches. People are taking risks to do something that they can believe in and they can have passion for. And that's really what this whole thing is about. We're going to have to take some risks if we're going to change our trajectory. We've got to take some risks. Now look, I happen to be incredibly blessed. I tell everybody every day, I love my job. 99% of the time, I love my, now there are those 1% days, but I love my job. And part of why I love my job is because the incredible people that I work with and the passion that they have every day for the job they do. And I look around the office on occasion and say, where would I be, much less where would the state be, but where would I be without that intense passion to accomplish incredible things? And look, when it comes to the activities of the development office, we can make them more complicated than they are, but we're salesmen. We're salesmen and women. The product is just a little different. We're selling the state of West Virginia. We're selling southern West Virginia, northern West Virginia, the eastern panhandle. And each one of them have certain assets that we try very hard to maximize. But I'm going to tell you, you know what the biggest challenge is? The biggest challenge in West Virginia right now. We have a tendency to have a really bad attitude about ourselves. And things are kind of tough. There's no question about it. Things are kind of tough. But a bad attitude is a little like a flat tire. You can't go anywhere until you change it. And if we don't change that attitude about what we can accomplish, we can't advance beyond this ditch. You have to preach. And I'm talking to people that I'm trying, I think most of you are converted, or you wouldn't be here today. But I'm trying to evangelize to people that will go out amongst this community, amongst this region, amongst this state. We have really good strengths. We have things to sell. We have challenges, but there isn't any place in this country that doesn't have challenges. I don't care. Pick the spot. Pick the spot. They have challenges. They just happen to be different. Now, right this minute, it's pretty clear that we have a major economic driver that has slipped into neutral. And we're not sure if we're going to get it back into drive. But we can't wait to figure out what the world commodity market is going to do next. We have people that need to find a future. Not a job, but a future. And so when we sit and talk about what we're here for, you know, the political catchphrase is always a job. But I maintain that it's really about a future. Where do we take ourselves? Where do we take our family? Where do we take our children? What is the future going to look like? I was in a meeting not too long ago in which I had a very thoughtful person. I was pontificating on the essential need of creating a highly skilled workforce in West Virginia. And I won't tell you exactly where she was from, but she might be a neighbor. And she said, you know, I'm trying to understand this. Why should I spend money I don't have to try to get my kids to go to college where they're not sure they want to go? Because when they come out, they still may not have a job here. And my answer may have been a little flippant, but it was intended to be sincere. We're not talking about location now. You're talking about a future for your child. And if we can't find them a job in Chapmanville, West Virginia, you're going to give them a skill, a life skill, that will take them someplace, somewhere. And hopefully along the way, they're going to make our state stronger. They're going to create the opportunity to grow here. They're going to become an entrepreneur. 85.7% of all the businesses in West Virginia actually have fewer than 20 employees. 20 employees. These are smart, intelligent, driven people who are making a difference in West Virginia. But we have to, as community leaders, we have to kind of dust ourselves off and move forward. I go about the country with my colleagues telling the virtues of West Virginia. And before I take one more step, I want you to know who they are. Now, they're not all here. They're not all here. But there's a few of them here, and you need to know who some of those folks are. Well, first of all, Kristina Oliver and her team, you've met Kristina. I can tell you that I was in state government when I wouldn't give you two bits for her office, and she knows it. She has absolutely revolutionized, repurposed, refocused, and re-energized the SBDC in West Virginia, and they're doing really great things for business people all over the state. In the international office, we have the folks that are working hard every day to create opportunities, not only from foreign direct investment, that's companies that are owned by overseas operations, now employ about 30,000 people in the state of West Virginia. 30,000 people. That's why we go to Japan. That's why we go to Europe. That's why we go to South America, because there are companies that are investing in our state and creating jobs and excited about it, I might add, excited about it. Steve Spence, who's the director of the international office, and you met Caitlin Ashley before. Those are just two of the folks that are out there on the sticks. And by the way, they are so outnumbered by other states, it's absolutely unbelievable. And they're doing incredible yeoman's work and creating new opportunities, both internally through exporting and externally by drawing new foreign direct investments into West Virginia. It is just as easy to imagine a Japanese company being located on that Hobet property as it is anybody else in the world. And then in the back is Chris Hopkins. Chris, raise your hand. Chris Hopkins is the Director of Business and Industrial Development. His group is split in half. Half of them work with existing businesses every day. And inside that group are a couple of those folks with us. One is Heather Van Adder, who's over here. And the other is a new person who hasn't been with us but a few weeks, maybe not even a few weeks. And he is the guy that's going to spend the rest of his life working in this area as long the rest of his life. Say, I'm planning his life. In this area, helping your businesses find a course that makes them successful. And it's Chris Pauly. Chris, would you stand up? You can't hardly miss him. And then the other half of the business and industrial development group is the investment group. And they focus on trying to attract new investment here to West Virginia. They're out looking for new companies or new expansions of existing companies all the time. That's what they do every day. And there's at least one person from that team here, and that's Sean Hill, who's in the back. These people, yeah, you can applaud for Sean. These folks are the troops on the ground. And what are they selling? What are they selling? They're selling a centralized location. West Virginia is within a single day's transport, a single eight-hour shift by ground transportation of half of the U.S. population and a third of the Canadian population. They're selling a low cost of doing business. I don't care what you hear from anybody else. The cost of doing business in West Virginia is 14% below the national average. Every major study, even when they don't treat us very well, every major study says one of the things West Virginia has gotten right is they have a very competitive cost of doing business. Cost of energy in West Virginia is on average, residential and commercial, about 30% below the national average. Cost of living about 14% below the national average. Home ownership, the highest in the country. That means the people are vested in their communities. They're loyal to companies that are loyal to them. These are all important factors. But it extends further than that. We have turn down all the campaign rhetoric. Our tax rates in West Virginia are now very competitive. The Tax Foundation ranks us 21st. It's a little better than average. But more significantly, the rates are lower than every single state around us. We privatized workers' compensation. Our rates went from the highest in the country to in the bottom three. When this whole country was going in the toilet during the Great Recession, they were borrowing hand over fist from the federal government to pay their unemployment benefits. West Virginia didn't do it, set up a strategy that if they ever got in that mess, they'd borrow from themselves. Why was that important? Because in every single state that borrowed, and that included every single state around us, the federal government made them pay interest back. And then they made them pay a penalty. And the law says none of that can come from the trust funds that you pay taxes to, which meant in every one of those states, where did it come from? The businesses in those states. Virginia borrowed almost $500 million. Kentucky borrowed almost $900 million. Ohio borrowed $2.1 billion and still hasn't paid it off. And Pennsylvania is well over $3 billion. It made a difference. When companies like Gestamp, more specifically, when Macy's located in West Virginia, it was at the height of the Great Recession. And they said, point blank to me, that was one of the most impressive factors to them, that we had figured out a strategy to deal with those fundamental costs to businesses that they could rely on. There was a stability in West Virginia they just couldn't find everywhere else. Now, there are those who also like to wring their hands about how small we are, we can't compete. Well, there's some truth. We don't compete with big checks. There are states that literally write checks to their business recruitment. They just write a check. In Alabama, when Polaris located their four-wheeler factory there, which is not as big as the Procter & Gamble project, the state of Alabama wrote them a check for $88 million. We didn't do that. In the case of Procter & Gamble, they got offered a 1,500-acre tract for free if they would locate in a competing state. We don't even have 1,500 flat acres in West Virginia. And they paid $20 million for the site in West Virginia. But I'll use their comments as an example of why I believe we can compete, and that includes in Southern West Virginia. Their comment was twofold, because when the deal was done and I was shaking hands and we were you know, toasting our successes and waiting for an announcement, I asked the vice president of the company. I said, listen, I don't know what we did right, but could you please whisper it in my ear? I'd like to do it over and over and over again. And he said, well, let me tell you. He said, you all were competitive. He said, there were probably bigger incentive packages out there, but at the end of the day, we have to figure out what it's going to cost us after the incentives are gone. And you stack up pretty well. We were pretty impressed. The location's phenomenal. You're right in the market, the heart of our market, where we wanted to be. We were pretty impressed with the workforce training efforts that are being made and how you would assemble a team for us. We like the labor pool. But I'll tell you the real reason. He said, you know, I know this is a big deal for West Virginia and you're going to pound your chest, and as we're going to help you pound your chest about this project. He said, and maybe this is I had said this is makes some people's careers in our office. And I said, he said, I got that. But he said, do you realize that there isn't anybody in Procter & Gamble that is here now that has ever been involved in building a plant in the United States from the ground up? Nobody. Been almost 40 years. There's only been one plant built in 41 years in the United States. And they picked West Virginia, and he said, as important as this is to you, you know, it's pretty daggone important to us. Our careers are kind of hung on this thing. And he said, I had your cell number. I had the governor's. I knew who every single decision maker was in the state and knew had their numbers in my wallet. And when something goes wrong, and something will, it always does, we knew how to get a hold of decision makers in West Virginia to address the problem. And believe this or not, Mr. Secretary, that didn't happen everywhere else. I was kind of stunned by it, to be honest with you. But it is a key piece of evidence of how we compete. I always refer to it in the office as concierge business services. Find out what we have to have. Find out what the impediment is to success and attack that impediment. Don't shotgun. We don't have enough ammunition. Find out where the challenges is. Well, ladies and gentlemen, that's what we have to do here. We have to identify the impediments to success and recreating a new economy in Southern West Virginia and attack them strategically, surgically, with the resources we can muster, if we're going to succeed. Governor talked earlier about Hobet. Now, he's passionate beyond words. But look at me. I live in Parkersburg, West Virginia. There isn't coal miners in my 100-year history of my family. I don't live in a coal mine section. But I'm jealous, because I can tell you the opportunity that could be created by a Hobet-like project is an opportunity. I'd like to have it about 16 different areas around the state. The good Lord gave us a spectacular place to live. He just left out the flat land. and in some places, it's more extreme than in others. So we have to find what we've got and take advantage of it. And we can. We can. The risks. I tell the governor all the time, you know, governor, we just don't do this, you know. And we don't. We don't do speculative land deals. But if we don't step, all of us, and I'm using this as an example more than a direction, if we don't step out of our comfort zone, if we don't step out of our comfort zone and identify routes to success, they will not come to us. They will not knock on our doors. If I walk down the halls of the development office and somebody's in their office, I'm assuming they're working on their next meeting, because they shouldn't be in their office that much. They need to be on the road. They need to be out. Steve Shops will be in Singapore, Vietnam, Qatar, Ireland, England, South America. They will be all over the globe this year, and they'll take your companies with them if you have your motivation. So all of this is about how we sell, how we see ourselves, and how we sell ourselves. And I can tell you with complete conviction, inside this room, which, by the way, may be one of the better collections of information and talent I've actually been around all at one time, inside this room are the strategies to move us collectively forward. We just have to organize them, prioritize them, and drive ourselves to them. And so I'm honored. I can tell you, I've been honored to be part of this whole morning. I'm thrilled with the people I get to sit on this desk with and the folks that have been in the previous panels. But I am nothing but optimistic, and that includes in Southern West Virginia.
Now, can this guy sell or what? So how do you feel? Good about our opportunities? Great about our opportunities? Keith, thank you so much for all that you, every day, representing us so well. So use what we've got. We've got to take some risks. And if we've got a flat tire, we better darn well change it and get that right attitude, folks. So we're going to do that. Now, the remainder of our program here, we've got about 10 minutes, is yours for questions and comments for our panelists. We've got folks walking around with microphones. Who has questions or comments? Please don't be bashful. The governor and Keith are very interested to get your ideas and comments, both here today and following this meeting. So please.
So we're out.
Yeah.
Golden opportunity. If you don't ask,
yeah.
I'm going to.
Yeah, please hurry before
Ann?
Tom starts asking.
This would be for Rusty Justice, and we're so fascinated and motivated and inspired by your story at BitSource in Kentucky. And if you could give us advice for doing it over here, or what would be your tips for us, short of moving you across the border?
The biggest challenge is really what we've just heard. You have to reimagine yourselves. You know, you have to find someone committed to it, and I'm sure I see people here that are committed to ideas. But you have to reimagine, and you have to get other folks to reimagine. I agree. The number one problem we face as Appalachian Americans is that it's not so much we have a poor self-image; we have a poor image of how we think other people see us. And I just think that's kind of a cultural legacy we all carry. And so recognizing and getting people to see it differently, that doesn't have to be the way it is. It can be different. And you just have to do it and believe in it and commit to it.
Others. So a lot today was talked about image. How do we see ourselves? Low self-esteem, low sense of the possible. Got to transform that. Other questions or ideas or comments for our panelists? I guess as I think about that, it seems to me, I'll offer this to whoever wants to grab this question and react. So I'm looking at you, Justin. I had the opportunity several years ago now to facilitate a meeting not unlike this in the Northern Panhandle. I was in Weirton. And Weirton Steel, which used to employ 14,000 people, employees probably less than 1,000. Keith probably knows the answer to that, or Justin. And ArcelorMittal now owns it. And this was a big, big community gathering to talk about what's the future. And Mark Galiptus, who was the head of the independent steel workers in that area, stood up in the back of the room for his comment. He said, for our entire lives and the lives of our parents and the lives of our grandparents, our economic development plan was really easy. Whatever Weirton Steel was doing was our economic development plan. And ladies and gentlemen, now we have to create that economic development plan. And it does seem to me we really are on the cusp, individually, I look at Stanley, and collectively, about really crossing over that. And assuming coal is going to continue to be here, and there's lots of opportunity, and the Rogersville, and we see all this, we still now have this challenge to really, what Rusty just said, I couldn't agree with you more, Rusty, that we've got to reimagine who we are. A new image for ourselves and a new image for our future, but we have to create that. And part of my excitement today is just seeing how many people are already doing that. But I think that's a big, I think we're kind of, we've got to move, it's a cultural, John Smolak and I were talking, John's comment was, this is cultural change, this requires persistence, this requires building infrastructure, this requires falling down as we're learning to walk and getting there and helping each other. I think this is big what we're about. So just reactions or comments, strategies on any of that. You see it the same way, panelists?
Yeah. I think one of the biggest challenges facing West Virginia is a lack of diversification. I mean that in a lot of ways, but specifically in the business community, whereas we've been very blessed with a lot of natural resources and things that can help us out, we required them to carry the burden for us for far too long. And so there's tons of opportunities. We live in a world today where you can do anything. I work with clients all over the world, all over the United States, and we're able to do that outside of Wheeling. And I guess what I would say the biggest thing is there's one word that's not allowed in my household. I have three small children, and that's can't. They're not allowed to say that word. And I think we need to get beyond that sometimes here to say, what are the possibilities that we can do? Because we can do anything. It might be very difficult, might take a lot of training, might take a lot of self-learning, might be taking a lot of help from other people, but we can do it if we put the effort behind it. And that growth from small businesses, when we talked about some of the stats here in the state, is really what's gonna propel us. You know, the single biggest thing I take pride in is that when I started, basically out of my basement 10 years ago, by myself, and today, I have 13 employees, we're looking to grow about another 33% this year. And even though that's not a huge number, that's 12 other people that didn't have careers here that might not be in West Virginia, or might not be able to feed their families or do other things that they're able to, that I play a small portion in now. So if you stick with it, if you beat your head against the wall long enough, you can do anything.
Thank you, Justin, very much. I think we have a question. I'm just wondering if you and your wife can say can't. I don't know. Kids? No.
There's all sorts of words the kids aren't allowed to say that we can, but we're not allowed to say can't either.
Okay. That's interesting. I wonder how that works. Yes, in the back there.
My name is Candace Hicksonbaugh. I actually work for the West Virginia University's Industrial Extension. We serve as the West Virginia's Manufacturing Extension Partnership. Recently, we paired with Southern. We have grant money from the state of West Virginia and the Department of Energy to provide all of our services for free in the counties of Logan, Boone, Lincoln, Wyoming, Mingo, and McDowell County. My question actually is for RCBI. What kind of financial assistance outside the Governor's Guaranteed Workforce Program and your apprenticeship funding can you provide for manufacturers?
Yeah, well, the early stage funding that I talked about, it's not actually money that goes to those groups, but it is, it's up to $10,000 to help them with their development of a prototype or using our manufacturing facilities. Outside of that, we work with folks a lot, but I don't know that we necessarily facilitate funding directly to them. Oh, thank you.
Connect West Virginia, RCBI, and Marshall University are working with the EDA through a network involving the University EDA Center and Scale Up West Virginia. I always forget which iteration we're on right now. But again, it's kind of taking candidate companies and analyzing what business services and manufacturing services they need and trying to adapt what we have to their needs through the involvement of services we have in-house. Consultants we might bring from other sectors for a specific specialized need. So that's it in a nutshell.
And Tom, let me tell you one of the challenges that hopefully assets that groups like RCBI and others, I don't want anybody to lose sight of the fact that we have a lot of businesses, support industries in Southern West Virginia that have almost singularly been geared to coal. We've got to find them some other product lines. We've got to help them reposition. We've got to help them sell their products outside of the coal industry, or they're going to go away too. So part of what this meeting is about is to try to help us help you identify resources to go to and talk about those issues to see if we can help you identify other opportunities using the resources you already have and the business structure you've already got in place. Because if we don't do that, we're going to lose the next layer of fabric within our community, and that's the businesses that are here that aren't directly in the coal business but are supporting the industry. So, and you're already seeing that fall off. So it's imperative that we hustle to do that now. And there are a lot of these companies that have great technical skills that could be making products to sell to other industries in addition to just coal. So that's part of what our message all day long is geared towards trying to help with. Please stand up, because I need everybody here.
We have a business innovations program for anyone in these counties where we take them through the process. Let's say you're just solely dealing with coal. Maybe you want to get into oil and natural gas, or you want to get into construction. We have a business plan where we're going to take you through all the necessary steps of other ideas that you have to try to help you diversify. We may find that two of your ideas are going to be great, one of them might not work. But before you invest any money, we can help you get there. A lot of safety trainings, OSHA trainings, that sort of thing, we're providing for free. ISO certifications for free. Again, just want to throw that out there since we haven't been able to do that before now.
Great. Thank you very much. We've run through our time, so let me, our secretary is going to come up here in a moment and bring us to a close. But before doing that, I want to ask all of you to join me in thanking our panelists for what they do day in and day out, the examples, and for their taking time to be with us today to tell the story and help show the way. Please join me in thanking our panel.
Nice job. Thank you. Well, ladies and gentlemen, this concludes most of the day. But I want to leave you with a couple thoughts. First of all, this can't be the end. This has to be a beginning. This has to be the start of a broader discussion. This has to be an opportunity to inventory assets and identify challenges. I will remind you what is on your table. If you have left notes, we'll pick them up, but if you want, you can drop them off. I happen to see Sean standing by the door, and by gosh, he'll be happy to collect those for you. I just assigned him a new task. He will be happy to collect those cards from you if you'd like. If you want to put your name on the back, you don't have to do this, but if you want to put your name on the back of the card, we may well be calling to follow up with you. We may likely be calling you to follow up anyway. I really sincerely hope that you've talked to some of the folks in the room with you. I looked around the room today. I saw folks from venture capital companies, folks that specialize in assisting small businesses and startups, workforce development experts in both public and higher education, and with existing and growing companies. We've heard from exporting groups. There's Tech Connect and the Chemical Alliance Zone and ARC and SBDC and higher education and public education and RCBI. It is an incredible collection of resources that has been here today, and we really want you to take advantage of them. That's what they're here. That's why they came. And finally, and most importantly, I need to thank you, because I need you to leave here emboldened and excited about the opportunity. I need you to leave here focused on making a change in your community that will carry us here and around the state forward. And so if nothing else, let me add one last line, which I try to add everywhere I go. Thank you for what you are already doing. Many of you are employing people. You're already creating jobs. You're generating tax dollars. You're contributing and participating in your community, and it is appreciated. It's just not quite enough. We need you to engage in what is really, truly an important activity that will change the course, I believe, of this region and hopefully this state. Thank you again for coming. Have safe travels home, and we'll see you next time.